Antoine, thank you for coming to see us this evening. I sort of move that, so every time I move, I don't lose my voice. You've written this magnificent book, You Will Not Have My Hate. Could I start off by asking you to take us back to the 13th of November?
It all starts just like in the book. It was a text message from Hélène's sister and asking me just, how you fine? It seems to me like it's a normal text message, and I don't like my phone, and don't like to answer to text message, so my friends could tell you that. I need a month to answer to a text message, so I didn't answer it. And after that, she asked me, are you safe? And from that moment, I felt that something was wrong, of course, and I turned on the television. I was reading a book, and Melvil was sleeping in his room. And I saw the football match between France and Germany, I think. Mm-hmm. And there was something wrong, but it was not clear. And after that, I turned on a news channel that I hate, and I saw the attack at Bataclan, and I realized that she was there, and so it started like that. And after that, I have to wait, because I the first reaction is you just want to go out and find her, but she was there. I was alone with him, so I had to wait for my brother and my sister to come to my place, and then after, with my brother, we go to every hospital in Paris all the night. And I think it's strange, but really the book starts with that, but the story starts when I sing at 7 a.m. with my brother. I told him, now we go back home, because I have a milk bottle to give to Melvin, so if I need to be a full-time father, it has to be the first day. Because if I give me the choice to say I'm too tired or I'm too sad, or, you know, I thought I will avoid it every time. It was a chance to avoid it, and I wanted to embrace it immediately. So I go back to my place and give the milk bottle.
So even at that very early stage, you were ready to, you were accepting the possibility of being a fathering alone.
Yeah, because I had to, but yet you cannot accept it till someone say it to you, and till someone officially said it. And before that, it's a very strange feeling, because it's, you have that, I just hope that perhaps it's just a mistake, she's not at hospital, but perhaps she's okay, I don't know where, but perhaps she's okay. There is a chance. And at the same time, it's not one and after another, it's at the same time. You have so much despair, because you say, no, it's impossible, she, you know, the attack was there, and she was there, and she's not answering the phone, and so it's very strange feeling. I don't know if there are words for it, but we should invent one, because that feeling is very particular.
So it's a sort of a gradual declining of hope and a gradual increase of despair, I suppose, as the time goes on.
The strange part is that the two feelings are powerful at the same time. Because, you know, all yourself is in that two paradoxal feelings at the same time. You cannot just say, perhaps she's alive. No. If there is one chance she's alive, she's totally alive, and it's totally different. And if there is a chance that she is dead, it's the same, and totally and entirely. So it's not graduating, it's like the most powerful feeling at the same time, and paradoxal feeling. It's Yeah, very strange.
Mm-hmm. Can you, Bert, tell us what happened next when you, at some point, the situation became clear, didn't it? And as you said, is that when a person of authority has to tell you that?
When I wrote that book, I chose the part I want to share. Mm-hmm. Because I think some parts are meaningful and meaning something beyond them, beyond just what they seem to tell. And some parts I want to just keep for me and my son. And this is a part I want to keep for me. Yeah, because, you know, I think it's the difference between interest and curiosity. I don't know if that moment had really a sense. I don't know if it's really interesting. But yes, instinctively, your curiosity want to know. Mm-hmm. But what would you learn if you really know? Mm-hmm. Nothing more. You know, you can imagine that. Mm-hmm. You can really imagine that. Everyone can imagine that. What that moment were for me. So I keep it for me. Yeah.
Tell us about writing the Facebook post, that what moved you to communicate in that way.
First, it was after 2 days waiting to find her, and I saw her, and she was like so beautiful, just exactly the same when I met her 12 years ago. And you know, that strange feeling that I was relieved when I saw her, because I spent two nights and I was thinking, she's alone in the dark and I can do nothing. And I don't know how to describe that feeling, but it was so powerful, it was so I just want to go back to Melvil and say, yeah, I have Mama in my hand and she's with me. And during the trip to kindergarten, the words start to go on my head, and I don't know how, I don't know why. I think it's an instinct response, and I really don't know why, but I know that I had to protect him and to protect myself. So this is the way I found to protect us from that and from the temptation of hating them. And because I think hatred is a comfort at that moment, should have been a comfort, because it's easy, it's just there. You just have to leave yourself to it, it's there. But I think after that, after you just leave yourself to it, it will grow and take all the space in your life. And your whole life will be about just that. So I have a responsibility to raise a son, and I'm the filter between the world and him. So I need to do my job at that time. And I think instinctively it take the form of that word that I put on Facebook, because it's only, I don't know, it's life is strange. It's just my brother was with me and I didn't eat anything for the weekend. And his mission that day was to force me to eat something. And so he said to me after I wrote it on my computer, now you just have to close the computer and go with me to have a meal. And I was okay. So just near the document, there was the Facebook page, I just posted it, and thinking that way the people close to me, my friend, my family, will know which way we want to go, where we want to go with Mandy. After that, it's crazy. After that, I didn't have, you know, the word didn't belong to me anymore. It's something else.
Did you feel that other people were expecting you to feel hatred and anger? You write a bit about being in a cafe and there's two men, and you overhear something where they say, people shouldn't die for nothing, and you ask the question, but does anybody die for anything?
It's a natural response to it, and perhaps some people can deal with it, but I thought that I wasn't that strong to accept it and then refuse. I know that if I just let her hatred enter in my life, I will be overwhelmed by it and I will lose control. But I think some people perhaps are stronger to deal with their hatred. And it's okay for them, but for me it was impossible. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And do you think very tied up with being a father? Do you think you were thinking as the father of Melvil?
Yeah, since the first day, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, people before, when Hélène was pregnant, they say to us that, you know, a little child, when it comes to, but the first stage of a little child, it's only eating and sleeping and pooping. But really, I didn't feel that any time. When he came to Earth, and that day, he has his eyes open. Just, yeah, the first second. And, you know, I spent some time just with him because the doctor need to warm him up after the... And I felt that connection immediately. Mm-hmm. It was never about just a stomach or... No, it was a strong relationship since the beginning. So I was really aware of that. Mm-hmm. And perhaps for me, you know, getting to my fatherhood completely was a way not to just abandon life, and because the temptation is there at that moment. Mm-hmm. And still, every day, I want to just escape my life. And sometimes I'm on the balcony and I'm just thinking about more simple, but yeah, it's impossible.
Because
so,
of Melville.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you wrote this thing on Facebook about not giving in to hatred, and then there was a huge response. And everyone wrote you letters and sent little gifts for Melvil. Just tell us about how that felt, to have to have unintentionally expressed something important at a time of... Express something so important to other people.
I think what I realized very quickly is that people expecting that kind of message. They were waiting for that. It's not that this message imposed a new idea or exceptional idea. No, it's not that. It just revealed what many people had inside them. But perhaps they don't feel legitimate to express it, or perhaps they don't have the words, or I don't know, but you know, they just jump on that message to someone say what I deeply felt, and yes, okay, and it is just directly touched. So yes, I'm allowed me to feel that and to fight for it. So that I realized it very quickly, but really, the place of the letter and the publicity of the letter, it's the place I give her in the book. It's like an anecdote. Mm-hmm. I lived at that time something much more important than just 200 or 70 million share. You know, I don't care about that. I didn't care about that at the time. So it was... And I must say that Melville can play with any books he like and doing whatever he wants with books, but he's not allowed to watch the screen. So so I have me to control myself, so I'm not allowed when I'm with him to watch my phone. And so it's very comfortable because I didn't saw it like, you know, the red light on the Facebook app. And, you know, I didn't saw it. I just saw it when I go to bed. So it was really not inside the house. It was just outside, something living itself.
The time frame of your book, it's a very short time frame, as it takes place over few days really. Was that intentional? Was that part of your idea that you would give a certain amount of things and keep other things to yourself?
There is two major reasons for that. The first is that I wanted to be the most sincere I can, and I know I had to write it quickly after that. Mm. And because if I had taken time to think about, oh, who's gonna read it, and perhaps, you know, for example, I didn't, when I wrote the book, I didn't not one time think about the fact that Melvil will probably read it. Mm. Because I didn't want any barrier, or I wanted to be sincere and real, and because I think it's very important. If, you know, the emotions are so important and so deep, and if you betray them, it was not that. So it was important to be quick, so it has to be just a few days after. And it's like you say, I choose what I want to share, and after that, you know, this story is in that book, and we can discuss about that publicly anytime you want. But what happening after, it's for me, it's back for me and for my son. Mm-hmm. If you want, we can have a drink after, and yeah, I will talk to you about that, but not publicly. Mm-hmm. So this is why it's only 12 days.
I think it's very difficult for any memoirist and any writer to keep a grip on what is for themselves and what is a point of being public. And I wondered whether you how you think about any future writing you may do. I'm just wondering whether you think sort of, if I write another book, maybe it'll be a mystery about an author who maybe killed someone or didn't kill someone, which is the detective novel that Antoine's reading at the start. Mm. I wonder whether this exists in its own box, or whether you think you might return to the subject of brief in future writings.
I don't know, but I don't want to think about it. Mm-hmm.
That's all right, I'll ask you something else. That's fine, don't think about it.
Really, because I think it's important when you think, you know, for me, literature is sacred. It's an art form. And, you know, this is why for 10 years I just wrote, I just start books and just throw it away because it was not as I wanted to be. And, you know, I don't know, but after Flaubert, I have to say something. So you know, you have to take risks, and if you're thinking about writing as a career, you're thinking about what was the emotion that pleased the people in my first book, so perhaps I can use it too, and you're insincere and you're not talking to anyone, you know. What I discover about writing is the act of writing, it's deep and it's wonderful. It was wonderful for me, even in that circumstances. But what I discovered too after that is that when you're alone in front of your computer, and after that you're alone with the people who read the book, you're alone with him. It's, you know, it's a very personal relation. So I can't lie to them. I can't just give them a recipe of what is a book and reflect on, yes, now they need to cry at that moment now. So I will just write. I started writing something and I don't know what exactly, but I don't want to know what. I think it's the way I make it because I don't want to make a business out of it. If I have to write a second book, it would just be something, and you will judge it and say if it's literature or not, but that's it, yeah.
You're reading a book at the start of the book, the detective novel, and I think, can I guess what book it is that you're reading?
Yeah.
I think it's the Harry Quebert Affair.
Exactly.
Ah, oh, yeah. Yes.
Wow.
That makes me feel pleased as a bookworm. So, could you talk to us a bit about how it feels to, or you said earlier on you didn't at the time think about Melvil reading it, but that occurred at some point. It's rather beautiful, is it, that he at some point will have this record? Or do you more feel an unease?
You're talking about the fact that he will read the book?
Yeah.
I don't want to think about it.
Oh, right.
No.
Yeah.
It's the same. It's not because I don't want to have any expectation about it. You know, I think, I don't know what to say, but one of the major problems in society, when you start a sentence like that, it always finishes bad, but I can say even though. So, is that you have so much expectation. So let the time do its job, and he will do it, and probably he will read it one time and say, oh, wonderful, or not, or probably a second time, or probably never, I don't know, and I don't want to know. But at the time he will read it, he will talk to me, I will be entirely with him. Okay, present time is important, but I don't want to expect anything.
And for you, if you forget us for a moment, just the fact that you have written down how those few days felt to you, you have always captured for you those, what that time felt like. Do you think, because sometimes I think we feel in the moment that we will always remember those things, but actually if you don't write them down, they fade. So you've caught that for you. Does that, do you feel, can you see that and feel pleased about it?
Now, yeah, I start now, but only now, because it was not the, at the moment it was just about the moment of writing, because I was just like suffocating on my room when Melvil was at Ben, and you're like alone and the walls are just falling on you and you don't have the space, you don't have, so writing was an open door to a place where I can breathe freely, and but I didn't want to escape reality. And writing about that was going to a place where imagination is the limit, but with my son and Hélène and the grief, and you know, it was, I didn't want to escape that reality. But I didn't remember the question. The writing moments were very important.
Would you tell
what
us...
What was the question?
I was asking you about...
You don't remember, is it?
No, I do. about the feeling that you've captured those times.
I think it's important.
Yeah. I realised as I was asking you the question that... Because this is something I talk about with other memoirists, that you think, when something terrible happens to you, you think the details of that will always be burnt onto your brain. And it's only later that you realise they aren't. And it's only, and other people say, write it down, and you think, don't be ridiculous, I will always remember it. And it's only later that you wish you had. I realised as I was asking you the question that the difference between you and every other memoirist is that you did write it down in the moment. So I was kind of asking you a question that presupposed you having to imagine what it would have been like if you hadn't written it down in the moment. It's all very complicated.
Yeah, too complicated for me.
Why don't we instead, would you tell us about the soup?
you want me to be an awful man? Yeah. The soup. Many love in that soup. Too much love for us at the time, because all the mothers at the kindergarten, they want to do something for us, because they saw us two guys and say, oh, how will he manage it? It's impossible. And so they prepare home-cooked meal. It was very nice. And I take it for Melville, and the problem is that Hélène and I wanted to be perfect parents, but we were just acceptable parents. So. The difference between perfect and acceptable was cooking. So Melville is used to organic, but prepared supermarket food. And so when he tastes the home cooked meal, it was he refused it. So it was like no. Then so okay. So I have to throw it away. But the day after, when they asked me, oh, did you like it? I was like, yeah, like it so much. And it continues. So what I, but he didn't eat any meal, yeah, I have to say. But we keep the love that the mothers put in it to prepare it, really. Because at that time we need to protect us. Because I need him to feel secure just with me. Mm-hmm. And so the word need to stay outside of our home. It was, I think, very important. And but we had just, you know, little answers for that little love. So we keep the messages, the letter that the mother put with the meal, and a little origami that is still on our living room. And okay, so we kept the love, not the food, and I'm sorry.
Has, since writing the book, have any of the soup donors asked you about it?
That I keep it from.
That's a private matter. I was wondering how it feels to be when you're part of a tragedy in which lots of other people are part of the same tragedy. Because you had your own tragedy on that night and lots of other people had a similar thing. And as when you write about the psychological support workers in their high-vis jackets and this sort of reluctance to be involved with them. And I wondered if you could talk to us a bit about that that feeling that there are other people in some ways having, I don't know, I guess some shared experience, but of course otherwise not having a shared experience with you.
This is two different things for me, because my reluctance for psychiatric support is very specific, and I don't know where it came from. I don't know why that, but you know, I'm afraid of, I call them microwave ideas. It's like, you know, you're telling some people a long story, very complex story, and then put it in the microwave, and it, after 3 minutes, it's like one sentence to resume what your whole story. Mm-hmm. I'm very uncomfortable with that, because I'm feeling like that. I know it's not normal, and perhaps I have to work on it with a psychiatrist. Yeah, this is a problem. So. But this is that. This is very personal. But after that, I met people who lived the same tragedy, and it was very rich and important. And some people ask me because of the letter, and yeah, I think there is a natural brotherhood, because at that moment everything is about you, and you know, no one wants to talk about his own problem because yours is too big. But you're still a human being. You need to share something. Mm-hmm. You can give, but you need to have in return, and even if it's problems. And so with that, with the people who did the same thing, you can talk about that, of course, but about anything else. Because you have the same, I don't know, I don't like the idea, but you have the same amount of grief, so mm-hmm. it's okay. You are at the same level, you can discuss anything. So it was important, and I think for the future, it's very important for me to know that it's not only me, because at the first time, as I say, I need to protect us, so I need to build that barrier and to protect us from the world. And so it was very personal. Mm-hmm. And after that, I know it is a collective story, so it's important for me, and I think in the future, it will be important for Melvin mm-hmm. to be able to meet people who did the same thing as he lived, and to know that he's not alone. And so, yeah, I think it was important to meet them.
Do you think, I can't think of a French phrase for this, but in English, we talk about how when someone treats you with kid gloves, which means when people are very soft and kind with you because they think they have to be.
Yeah.
And that obviously that prevents normal life in a way carrying on So I was wondering if in your brotherhood, I guess, no one is having to treat each other with kid gloves exactly. because yeah. you're in the same boat. So we've just got yeah. gone idiom crazy. Yeah.
This is that, and you know, it's like. For me, it was not like that because I had a close friend, really close, and it was easy for me to share with them. And I felt support with them, really. But I met a girl who contacted me, and she hadn't left her home since the 13th of November, and we were like after the release of the book in France, like April or May. So it's like more than 6 months alone. At all, because when she discussed with friends, she felt like she can't say everything because they won't understand. Or so it's important to meet people who live the same thing, I think. But it's very strange because I thought will it change with time? And no, mm-hmm. The photographer in the morning. I don't remember the newspaper, but the photographer, you know, he looked at me with a different eyes, and I didn't know why. And after the photo shooting, he said to me, I listened to you on Radio 4 this morning, and I did the same thing, and I lost my leg. And yes, we were about to have a beer together, because, yeah, this brotherhood, even there is no, even in a different country, even many years after, mm-hmm. it's still there. Mm-hmm. You look in the eyes and, okay, we are the same, we are brothers. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, it's important, I think. Mm-hmm.
Do you feel, there's a bit in your book where you talk about, it's called The Right to Doze, this chapter, mm-hmm. and you talk about, and suddenly I'm afraid. Do you mind if I...
No.
And suddenly I'm afraid that I won't be able to meet people's expectations. Will I no longer have the right to lack courage, the right to feel angry, the right to be overwhelmed, the right to be tired, the right to drink too much and start smoking again? And it carries on. I really hope you do have the right to do those things.
Yeah, I do. And I fall, and yeah, regularly, yeah. And it was really, I think we can go back to the previous question. It's why perhaps it was important to write it down at the time, because it changes very quickly. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, the normal life go back again very quickly. And so people just look at you, and if you want to fall, you fall. And the friends and family are there to just give you a hand to go back on the track. So. Mm-hmm. But at the moment, I felt that. I was like, you know, a totem, you know, like a symbol. Mm-hmm. So, and I have to receive everything, and I know it was not just me and my son, it was all the victims of the mm-hmm. attacks. We were just there to receive it and give back to mm-hmm. everyone. But it was heavy at the time, and but now it's very light. Mm-hmm. So, and it's also because of the book, because now, just after the attacks, it was only about terrorists and your reaction, and you're so wonderful. And now it's about fatherhood and love and raising a child and many different things. So, yes, it's very different now. Mm-hmm.
Because obviously life is complex, so I hope you don't feel the pressure to. I'd imagine people are always telling you how wise and brave and heroic you are, which is wonderful, but it's a pressure to have to be all those things.
I think the problem of this, if you build a statue, mm-hmm. you can just look at it and say, oh, that's the hero, okay, so he's taking charge of it. Mm-hmm. And the meaning of the words was that we have collectively to taking charge of it. If you felt something reading the words and the Facebook post, the book, or okay, you are as responsible as I am to care for that word and to live with the spirit of that word. So when you have a statue, you can just look at the statue and it's wonderful. And okay, me, I can live my life. No, there's no statue. You know, this is why I want the. This is why I also want the book to tell that we are just human, and it's not, we are not just a story. Mm-hmm. And it's deeper than that. Mm-hmm. And so you have the responsibility too. It's mm-hmm. not only my son and I, and even when we look good on the picture, it's not just that.
I think it's one of the reasons why I really like the soup chapter as well. It's kind of, you're being right out there with the notion of being flawed. I wonder, would you also tell us, because I have done this and not in such sad circumstances, about the fingertips?
Yeah, I think it's a universally. Yeah, the feathers don't have the names. I have so many fathers who came and talked to me and say, after reading your book, I cut my thumbnail for the first time. Yeah, thank you very much. And I don't know why, but it's like that. And so, yeah, the first time I had to do it on my own, this was the only things that led that I didn't do it myself. So this anecdote, it's about raising a child, the fact that you are just facing the necessity and you just have to do it, and you don't know it before, and you don't know if you did good after, but mm-hmm. you just have to do it, mm-hmm. just like that. But yeah, this is so, I don't know, you know, you're projecting many things on a children's head, but you know, I just rip and cut him part of the skin, and but he didn't cry. He just looked at me like, okay, you have to work a bit, but okay, continue.